Les Weech. I'm an independent author. I'm the author of currently two novels, The Journals of Bob Gertrude and Caught. And the reason I love doing this panel, and I feel pretty confident saying it's become kind of a staple here at Awesome Con, because they ask me to do it frequently, is my hope is that you all are people pursuing finishing a novel and getting published. And I would like you to do it, not make the mistakes that I made. There's enough out there in the world. People love good stories. People love entertainment. And my hope is you guys are passionate about the stories you've told. You've written them. They're ready to go. And now you're ready to publish them, but you're maybe not so sure what the best path is. I still don't necessarily know I know what the best path is, but I can tell you the wrong way. And so I'm going to kind of tell you my story. Tragic and sad though it may be, there will be laughs, there will be tears. But once that's over, I'll open it up to questions, because really what I want to do is I want everyone in here wanting to publish to feel like they can walk out that door and then publish. Does that sound like a plan? So in 2014, I went to a different convention that was equally entertaining and fun, and I ran into an author who is a huge inspiration to me, and I had the opportunity to actually like talk to him for a while. And I was sitting there moping because I'd gotten my rejection letter from agents, and the only letter I got from a publisher was paraphrased something to the effect of, what are you punishing me for? So I was sitting there and feeling sad for myself, and he goes, well, self-publish. I'm like, what do you mean? You know, dude, I got like a lot of friends, and I don't know any of them that have three books out that aren't making money. You know, bestseller, all that other stuff, I don't know, but they're making money. And it's a path that a lot of people, it doesn't have the stigma it used to anymore, which is true. In fact, I did my blog in January, and my top three reads and two of my top three favorite books for the year were written by independent authors. And I read a pretty good mix of both. And when I got that information, I took a list. But in the list that I took, I made a mistake in looking into a self-publishing company that advertises its strength in, well, for starters, we'll do all your editing, we'll do your marketing, we'll do this. And the other temptation they offer you is, they made me feel like they're kind of like the minor leagues. And if your book does well, it'll elevate you up to the majors. You get one of the big five. So my dream came true in March 3rd, 2015. This book came out, The Journals of Bob Drifter. I was amazingly proud of it. So let's take away the $8,000 I spent on marketing that they said they would do for me. They didn't tell me they would charge me $8,000. Let's take away the $6,000 they charged me for editing. To publish this, just to print this, they charged me $2,000.
For how many copies?
Well, like, once it's published. And then I have to order my copies. But to get it out into the world, it just to print it, if I said no, don't do anything to it, just print it and make it available, it cost $2,000. I didn't know what I was doing. I was a guy who'd written a book and wanted to be an author. And they were the ones who said, yeah, you can do this, we can do this with you. And I didn't know any better. And my family loved me, and they're like, nah, Matt, you don't do well when people tell you no. You know, I will talk a little later about how you guys need to learn to ignore the word no in most situations. Sometimes it's an important word. But in the world of quit your dreams, no is a word you should just learn to ignore. So I was out there, and I was writing, and I was working on my second book, and I realized that this book was, I don't charge this cover price for this book, and never have. But according to the cover of this book is $43.95. And I was like, well, they're publishers, they know what they're doing. They set the cover, they must think I'm going to be famous. because I wouldn't pay that much money for a book, but they must think I'm ready to go. No, they don't care. Companies like that don't make their money off your sales. Companies like that make their money off of you giving them your money under the impression that they will help you sell the book. And that is what I learned to the grand total tune of $20,000. I saved my whole life to be published. And I can say with pride that I spent that life savings making my life dream happen. My regret is not what I did. My regret is not being informed about what I was doing. And this panel is designed to not let that happen to any of you. So the thing I did that was right is I started making friends. My initial response was like, these authors are like cutthroat, elbow you in the face, kick you, you know, trip you on the way to your panel kind of guys. Because I was raised in a very competitive day job. You know, I'm a photographer in the Navy, and if you don't have to throw an elbow, you're not going to get your shot. but the shock on my end was I was just tooling around online, and I saw a cover that I liked. And I'm like, I really love your cover. And the author was like, great, great, thanks, I hope you try it out. And I'm like, well, you got me now. Because what do you say? Like, I'm online, and people are talking. Now, a lot of people are like, no, I just don't buy your book. But I'm like, no, I said I liked your cover, and you were very nice to me. So I bought the book, and then, like, we started talking on Twitter, and then we started messaging, and then she literally adopted me into, like, an independent author group called The Slush Brain. If you're curious, her name is C.L. Snyder. She's an amazing author. 2 years running, she has written one of my three favorite books. Yes, she is my friend, but that does not change the fact that she is an amazing author. Adult content for views below 18, not a whole lot, but there's adult content in there. So parents don't buy your kids that book and they'd be mad at me. So I started talking and they threw it around, and that's how I found out about CreateSpace. I'm not pounding the table advertising for CreateSpace. There are other tools available. I'm just telling you I figured out how that one works. So I went to CreateSpace and I go, okay, I have a book. What are you going to charge me to publish it? They're like, well, do you have everything? I'm like, yeah. I don't know, $400. And I wanted to know. They didn't understand because I'm on the phone with them, and they didn't understand why I was making actual physical retching sounds. And they're like, what, are you okay? Like, they thought I was having a heart attack. I go, no, that's $1,600 less than I paid. And then I immediately did the math, and I go, I could have published 7 more books. So then this one came out. This is Caught. This is my second full-length novel, and I'm very proud of it. And it went out into the world, and it was a very easy, streamlined process. If you're curious and you want me to like take you step-by-step through that, I can do that a little bit later once I finish my tragic story. And we'll go through there. But the point is, I published this book. Let's be honest. I needed to have it edited, and that was about 1,200. $1,200. Look, editors cost money, people, and you need editors. I was very proud of this, and I paid editors, and they said, hey, we edited your book, and it's amazing. And then I published the book, and then I went to get the audio version made, and I read it again with my eyes open this time. And I was like, wow. Now, any book you do, the industry standard is about 3%. You're going to find typos. I edited this. I had two other editors edit this, and then the audio narrator was narrating the book, and I go, nope, that's a typo. Far fewer, but you need to edit your novel, so it's going to cost money. So the grand total to publish this book was I want to say max 1,000. But that's for everything. This book, just to print, $2,000. This book, totally done, $1,000. Cover, editing, additional artwork, cover. Then I realized that this book is doing well at its ridiculously high price. Imagine what would happen if I released it again and didn't charge people limbs. So I published this book through CreateSpace, but I remembered I was trained by the Navy to be awesome. They're like, what did you do in the Navy? I was awesome. No, like, what did you do? Whatever awesome is, I did that. That did. Because people are like, in the Navy, you do have specific jobs, but really, in the Navy, when you're adopted and trained to be the Navy, what they teach you how to do is whatever needs to happen, make that happen. That's the Navy rule. No offense to my Marines and my soldiers and my airmen and my Coast Guardsmen, but in the Navy they train you to figure things out. Especially in my job, because I had like one little thing where I joined the Navy because I wanted to be a writer. And so I joined and they said, well, you can be a writer, but you also have to take pictures, do art, do graphic designs, layout, write magazines, and if you're not doing anything, can you go ahead and do a weekly newscast on the ship? I'm like, well, okay. So off I went. But they gave me all these skills that anyone with an internet and YouTube can figure out how to do, like how to work a graphic design program, how to work photo enhancement programs, and how to work this thing called Word programs. So I put in all the work. I still hired, I still had an editor take a second swing at this, and I promise you there are errors in here, but we are humans, and there will be errors in your work. So I published this. Do y'all want to know how much it costs to make this book available to you? $0. I published it for free. I did all the work. I took all the time. That's the cost. I did have an editor take a look at it, and that was I don't know, 3 cents a word, whatever that is. It's 130,000 words. So if you really want to do the math, there it is. But it was free, and every book I'm putting out since cost me the things I know my book needs. My book needs a cover. My book needs an editor because I forgot how to spell when I was two. These are things that I need. But I became much more efficient and much more intelligent about it. Where do I have to grow? I'm still figuring out marketing. Because I've written books that I believe in. No one knows I exist. Hi guys, I exist. Please buy my stuff. Yes, I published this book for free, but I would like $9.99. Or this one's $12.99. But that's just value. If you sell the book for too low, then like, why are you selling me this for so low? It must be garbage. And I'm like, well, okay. So you gotta fall into the market so that people know it's worth what it's worth. It seems weird, but that's kind of where pricing falls into it. Also, there are a lot of sources you can go to look at. They tell you where physical edition books should fall out based on what word count they have. So questions I usually get that I'll answer before I open it up to questions I don't already figure you're going to have. What do editors charge? I don't know. How good an editor do you want? The good ones cost money. The good ones cost a lot of money. My editor is a new up-and-coming editor. Why I like her, her name's Sarah, by the way, Sarah, good one. She edited C.L. Snyder's book, and then C.L. Snyder sent it to her really, really good editor, as in, this guy works for authors I want to be like one day. And that editor looked at this book and said, I don't have anything for you. And I publish it. And I go, I'm going to hire that one, because apparently she works. So they can range anywhere from, there are some who are trying to kick in the door, and they'll charge you like a half a cent a word. Be wary. They're trying to get their foot in the door. Are they really good people who just need opportunities, or are they people who just want to make a quick buck and you'll do? Do your research. I recommend buying a few of the books that they've edited and reading them, and if you don't want to throw it across the room, then maybe you found a deal. All right? How much does it cost for my covers? I pride myself on my ability to evaluate covers. In fact, every month I do a book cover of the month bracket. Every day I pick a book cover that I think stands out for some reason, and then a bunch of people vote on it, usually a couple thousand, and I buy that book and I read it. So I know a thing or two. What that gift has done for me in 10 years of editing photographs for the Navy is I know what good art looks like. I also know what a guy who needs an opportunity looks like. Now this guy was my best friend in junior high, so that was just a phone call. Hey buddy, I know you're famous and stuff, but will you help a guy out? And so it helps when you know people. I needed something different for this one, so I went to DeviantArt, and I looked around and looked around and looked around, and I collected the art I wanted and said, any one of these guys has the ability I need. Now, who has the price I'm willing to deal with? And I found this guy, an amazing artist. And then, through my book covers, another artist approached me, and we've been working together he's become my commissioned artist. And Sarah has become my commissioned editor. And I like living in a world where I know who I'm dealing with all the time. It makes sense? Marketing has become an idea where what I've learned is you have to realize that you're honestly the only human being on earth who wants to sell your book. Okay? I want you to sell your book, but I have to sell my books. So you want to generate what they call a platform. That means about a year and a half before your book comes out, you want to start blogging. You want to start tweeting. You want to start Facebooking. I don't know the social media adjectives. That's why I'm not so good at marketing. But you want to build your platform so that you have people waiting for your book. The other trick that people don't learn is people don't buy your books. People buy you. That's why that platform and that area matters, because they get to know you, they get to like you, they get to trust you, and then when you publish a book, then what they're giving you with their money is, one, I like you, so I'm going to send $12 your way. Right? If I buy you a cup of coffee, I'll buy you a book. Then they read your book, and that is what determines whether or not they decide to like you as an author. So this book is selling this book, and this book will sell the next book. But that's kind of the way that the train runs. But more often than not, my cover stops people dead in their tracks. The number of people I see, like, remember that? I'll turn around and look at the book, and they're like, can I tell you about it? And they're like, well, now you're stuck. Usually because of the handcuffs I put on. But that kicks down the door. The other thing that gets me sales is feeling like, wow, you're not a complete jerk. And I like you, and I have $10. I don't know what to do. Here you go. What makes it work is when they read the book because they like you, and it's actually not garbage. The editors make it not garbage. The love you put into that makes it not garbage. Before I open it up to questions, do you guys want me to go over what I call my writing process? The layers and number of drafts I do. Is that a thing you're interested in?
Yep.
Okay. So, first thing I do is I mope because I'm an artist and no one appreciates me. I do that for about the amount of time it takes me to wake up and sit up. That's my mope time. Don't out me. It's way more than that. It's every moment I'm not actively writing. But you gotta, at some point in time, you gotta get over your mopes, okay? All right? So then what usually happens is at some point in time I have like one idea and that idea coalesces, and it just kind of all bounce around there. At one point in time, a friend asked me, do all the characters in your head have a meeting? And I said, yes, but they never invite me, those jerks. How old are we? Are you good? I'm gonna let one fly and we'll see how that goes. Eventually I start to see a common picture, and that's when I start pursuing the idea. The next thing I usually do is I develop my characters. Who are they? What are their goals? Every character should be the main character in their own arc, their own plot. Now, I would probably be more successful if I was more diligent with it. But at the end of the day, I'm like, no, I just need a guy to give him coffee. I don't need to know why he's selling coffee. The better author's like, no, that guy's selling coffee because he's a single parent and his kid wants to go to college and this is his third job. And I'm like, yeah, but he's just like, the whole scene is like, here's your coffee, sir. And that's it. No, he needs a backstory. He needs the truth. I don't go that far because I want to publish a book this year. All right? But if you're a certain author who wrote a King Killer trilogy that was supposed to take 3 days, you can take more time. Because people already love you. They will wait forever. And wait. I'm still waiting. I will wait forever, though, patiently. This is supposed to be funny? We'll see. Don't tweet at me. So the wow, that joke made more sense than I thought it would. I thought that was an Easter egg joke. So I'm posting this on YouTube, folks. Anyway, develop the characters. I develop the characters I know have some sort of recurring role. If he goes to that same coffee shop and I see that guy more than once, I might actually develop a whole arc for that guy. You may never see it, but I want to know what's going on. What does have a tendency to happen, though, is I fall in love with that coffee guy. And I'm like, yeah, he does have a kid. And that kid's important. And in chapter 28, that kid's going to get this. And then this is going to happen. I'm like, crap, that character's a main character now. And then my book is 100,000 words more than I thought it would be. It's okay for the story to be larger than you anticipated, but it's more successful when you develop that. Now, for me personally, I'm not big on description. I think Dickens is torture. If I ever wanted someone to like feel agony, I would make them read the first 3 pages of A Tale of Two Cities, which, if you look very carefully, you will realize that whole 3 pages comprises of exactly one period. I would never do that to you, I promise. Many periods. That being said, I'm not so good at description. People are like, wow, I wish your writing was more vivid. I'm like, what do you mean? He's in a room. What does the room look like? What color are the walls? I don't care. It's a room. You're going to leave in a minute. No, I want to see it. I want to be there. I'm like, okay, I get that. Fans want scenes. I just want people to do cool things. But human beings want, like, to create a movie. And my brother, he's my primary alpha reader. I'll cover that in a second. My brother was like, no, dude, like, you're hard at this because you have a freaking high-def D-box theater in your mind. And you think everybody has that. Don't. And like, they don't. He goes, no,
you're weird.
So, yeah, my brother often sounds like that when he gives me this really epic advice. Like, he's like,
you need to write another book.
I'm like, oh, okay. So after I develop my characters, I develop what I call my settings. These are the places I know my characters will go. And I describe them to a degree that annoys me. I know when to stop when I want to throw my laptop across the room. I'm like, okay, that's probably pretty good. And then, after I do that, I take my characters and I do what I call my plotting. I think about, like, what's their arc? Now, there's two types of arcs. There's the plotting arc, okay? She goes to the store, she buys some cookies, she buys some milk, she goes home and realizes she got the wrong kind of milk. So then she throws the milk out the window and ends her life because she'll never be the same after having 2% milk. That probably would be a very successful novel, but go with me, Holmes. Those are good. You need things to happen in your books. But audiences today apparently forget what it was like when they watched episode 4 when they were young, and now they want, like, every character to have this deep metaphysical understanding of life at the end of the story. I don't necessarily buy into that, you know, but I'm telling you right now, everyone I talk to says, no, characters need arcs. So you got to think about, who is this person now? And who is this person going to be at the end of your story? How are these events going to change that person? Or how is he going to go through these events and change the people around him? Those are your options in the world of having a fulfilling novel. You creative thinkers can stand behind whatever you do. Every now and then I stand behind him. I'm like, no, that guy does this. Yeah, but it doesn't change him. I go, because he's awesome. And he doesn't change his morals because life is hard. You have to decide what your arc is going to be. Are you going to have one? What type of arc it is? There are a million books and a million blogs that talk about arcs and character arcs and narrative arcs. Do some research, pick one, do that, and go from there. Once I have that done, I take all of those plottings. And remember, I did that for every character. And now what I do is I weave them in and I stitch them together. And that creates my outline. And then I throw it out a window and just type. No, I don't. I try to pay attention to the outline, but I'm a discovery writer at heart. So I type, and I just go. I call that my discovery draft. That's the thing where I'm like, I've written a book, I am a genius, respect me. No one should ever look at my discovery drafts, including myself, but I have to because I want to write more books. So then I do a first draft, and I'm like, I think I'm willing for human beings to look at this. But then I need these things called alpha readers. Alpha readers aren't my fan base. I don't want to show them my bad stuff. You know, alpha readers are the guys like, okay, so in this book, I have this person who does this really cool math thing. Only problem is I don't know anything about math. So I find people who know about math, and I say, read this book, read this section, and make sure that makes sense. You know, I have a book coming out next year about an alien race, and I borrowed a lot from the Jewish religion. So I have a friend who is very, very Jewish, and I said, read this and make sure I'm not insulting you. And so she read through it, she goes, no, you got a good mix here, you're not blatantly ripping off my religion, but the elements that are in there are done appropriately. I said, thank you. So those are your alphas, those are your, in my business, we call them your SMEs. So they go through and they look through and they make sure that your book makes sense in the world you're doing. If you're doing tactics, find a buddy in the army and say, hey, if you kicked in the door and stood there, what would happen? Well, you'd be shot and you would die, because don't stand in doors.
What does SME mean?
Oh, our subject matter experts. SMEs, subject matter experts. So then I get their feedback back, and they tell me how little I know about their life story. And I go, that's why I have you. And I apply all of their feedback, and I answer it. And then I send it out for what I call the developmental edit. So I send my first editor a product that is sensible and reasonably written, and then she annihilates it because, no, that doesn't make sense. Her eyes were green in chapter 2, and now they're blue. What happened? Well, you know, it's a different light. I know how light reflects. But they called me out, and they said, his name was Jim in chapter 3, and he's Bob now. I said, well, you know, people can change who they want to be. No disrespect. His name isn't a thing now? Is that an interesting thing? Anyway. So she called me out on all my inconsistency, all the issues with my plot. Is my character successfully satisfactory growth? Does my plot progress in a way that makes sense? Does it lag anywhere? So then I finish it up, and now I'm ready for my audience to look at it. So then I look for beta readers. So I'm like, who is a fan of this genre? So I post a blog, I send out a tweet, and then I get people who are like, oh, I like those kinds of books, and I want to read stuff for free. I'm like, I have free stuff. Here you go. And they read it, and they give me their feedback as fans of the genre, as fans of these types of things. I apply that, I send it back to my editor, because I don't know how commas work. I teach in a school where I tell them how commas work, but when I type my book, I guess I just don't care. No, the book is 30,000 words, or 60,000 words, 80,000 words, 130,000 words, and you make mistakes because you're human, but her job is to find them. Then I find a cover artist, I get a cover made, I write a book blurb, then I go out, I lay out the book. Today they use Word design programs, which really threw me for a loop, but they actually out-design books in Word programs now, which really just sounds wrong, especially if you worked in the design field. But then once I get that done, I send it out to CreateSpace, and they say, oh, you're done? Well, here you go, it's published. And out it goes, where all of you loving human beings read it and enjoy it, right?
Yes.
No. It's how it goes. So that's the process, and hopefully that seriously, guys, this is how I do it. Other people do it this way, and I usually try to recruit other authors to kind of pitch, like, this process works for me, this process works for you. The trick is, find the process. It will take time. There will be pain. You will make mistakes. Just look, if you go to publish your book and they say, we'll publish your book, if they're not willing to do it for less than $600, they're ripping you off. They're lying to you. They're not helping you. And you can publish a book for far less money with people who still don't care whether or not you sell your book, but they're just trying to get your book out. Who can I answer questions for? What am I at for time?
Doing good. You're on a 20-minute 10.
Oh, wow. That's got to be a record for me. Yeah. What do I got back in the room? Can you give him one of these?
Yep.
What?
I just peeked online quickly. I don't think you have, like,
electronic. Oh, my goodness.
Oh, my books? Yeah, all my books are electronic. Is that...
Well, then I guess if you do, I was wondering, how do the considerations for a publishing electronic be different
from the hard copy? For me, it's whether or not I want to. With this one, I had CreateSpace make this book, and then I had them make it available for Kindle, and I just clicked the public button. Yep.
Okay, who's it going to?
It's the guy who just asked the question.
Yeah.
So the... For re-releasing this one, and now what I'm going to do from now on is I go through CreateSpace to make the physical book available, and then I go through KDP to make the ebook available. I will tell you this, I already know right now, sooner or later, I'm going to have to go beyond Amazon, but it's a good start to start with the biggest market. You will want to eventually go through to your Kobos and your Nooks and other things, but right now I'm just trying to figure this one thing out, and I will grow as I gain confidence. And there in the back.
So since you said that one of your things you need to work on is marketing, since you are using Amazon, what's the main way you market now?
Conventions. Like, I convince you all I'm good at writing when you buy my books. Maybe I should say that after you buy my books. Anyway, the conventions is my number one sales rep. The other thing you have to do is have a very strong social media platform. The thing that's weird about me and a challenge I face is people are like, no, who are you when you're not writing? I'm like, literally, that's all I do. I also, I post Dead by Daylight, videos every now and again, because I like that game, and I'm pretty good at it. But the people who are more sociable are going to be more successful than me. Because people are like, what else do you talk about? I go, dude, I talk about writing, football, and video games. What do you got? And they're like, I don't want to talk about this. I'm like, oh, yeah, so I don't say anything because you don't want to listen to that. But I love talking about plots and structures and outlines and character development and character studies. And other people are like, that sounds like a college course. I mean, wouldn't it be great if I just lived my whole life attending college, reading books and talking about it? They're like, yeah, but you can't make money on that. And so it gets to them. Other people, like I have one acquaintance who knew me, and one time I talked for must have been 45 minutes, he's all,
I don't care. The hero one, it looked cool. Like,
no, but you don't understand. That was his decisive moment where he took,
I don't care. He cut it half with a lightsaber. It was cool.
So it's harder for me because I love what I do so much. It's all I want to talk about. But it's a disadvantage because when you're trying to reach the social media market, you're trying to, and you're not going to attract them with, I know about writing, I know about this, please buy my book. You're going to attract them by being a decent human being who they like, and then you'll gain followers, you'll gain a platform, and that's the same thing here in the convention. You get to know me, you get to like me. Sure, I don't know you from Tuesday, but this 2 minutes has been worth $12 to me, and I will evaluate whether you're going to get any more of my time when I read the first page of your book. I wish I could tell you more, but that's what I got figured out so far. Is that okay?
That's perfect. Thank you.
All right. You had a question?
I did. So thank you. I'll return the favor. I published my first book. I basically made my own publishing company so that I didn't have to look like an independent author.
Okay.
I considered the Create Space thing, so thank you. I did a little bit different route,
mm-hmm.
But I was wondering. So basically, I just had a printer print.
Mm-hmm.
A small number of them, and then the Kindle Direct. But when you are using CreateSpace to publish,
mm-hmm.
is there a stock of books there that they can sell on Amazon Prime?
Once they publish the book, it becomes available there. Things to watch out for. What happens is the term is print per request.
So it's printed on demand. How quickly do people receive it then?
Oh, very quickly.
Really?
Like, you know, once you order it, it arrives about the time any other book arrives.
That's amazing. And do you have any control over, like, the quality of the book cover or the...
Well, I mean, I have, like, I'm a control freak, so I made all the calls.
Okay.
They will do things for you. And I've seen some of their work. I don't have any particular beef. But usually if you see a bad book that's done poorly, the author has the accountability in that place. Because all they do is hit the print button. It's like there's some poor bastard in there who just hits this button. He like it's bing, one order pop, okay. And then it falls down there. I don't know if he ever even touches the book. But it's your job to make sure your book is the way you want it to read. I will say this, while I was going through this process, they were very invested in making sure that it didn't look like garbage. So they'd call me every now and then and be like, hold on, you might want to look at this, you might want to look at that. But I'd be like, no, damn you, post it anyway. And they're like, all right. Life. The danger to print per request is when you use an ink drum, they can't just like pour a little bit of ink in there. That's not how it works. You have to open the whole drum.
Right.
So they have to charge you what they need for that drum. So what that does is it elevates the cost a little bit more. There are other tricks you can do. Like my book isn't available through any of the. The only way to get my book is to order it through CreateSpace, order it through Amazon, or come get it from me. And that limits my audience, but it counters the price. Because if I open all that, then everyone wants their cut, and the poor jerk who had to pour that whole drum has to get his paycheck too.
Right.
So that does tend to elevate the cost. One of the major reasons these hardcovers were so expensive is at the end of that $43, I still saw $1. But everyone has to get paid. So print per request is a little dangerous. It works more, though, when they get more orders. So I tend to order about 20 to 30 a convention, and that helps offset some things. So did that answer your question?
Yeah, more or less. What do you find the price, like what's the cost per print? They're charging like $10 a book to print it?
They tell you the price per copy when you go in to make an order.
Okay.
And then it's up to you to decide what you're going to charge. You're supposed to make money on your work.
Okay.
You know what I mean? Each author makes a decision. I think about, like, two things. What do other books in my genre go for? And, you know, when I looked at this one, I go, this book could easily go for another $5. But look, I don't need to make 300%. So I found the middle ground, a lower end of what a book like this would normally cost. And this book, I put right about where the market for it is.
How much did you say that was?
To buy this is $9.99.
That's amazing.
Well, thank you.
Is Is that variable on the length of the book, Matt?
The word count, number of pages, is page count matters not to anyone but the printer. He's an important dude, but the only time you should be talking page count is when you're talking about printing, and that determines the price of the book. What do you got?
Yeah, well, when you're in page space, it will tell you this is the minimum you can charge for it.
Right.
And then you can do whatever you want.
Okay, but for perspective,
I think you have
a printer that I trust. And then you have said, so good. I had them on the runs. But now when I sell my book on Amazon, my fulfillment by Amazon fee alone is $8. So, and then I had to pay maybe $5 a book to print them. So I can't sell my books for $9.99. I lose money on every copy.
Yeah, so your price per copy, because everyone gets a cut.
Right.
By going it alone, I save all that money and I give it back to you guys because I love you. No, really, I want you to buy my book and you're not going to pay $20 for my book.
Right. Okay.
I'm not going to pay $20 for that author who met me and inspired me to publish. I'm not paying $20 for his book, and he's a consistent number one bestseller. So you're not going to pay $20 for my book.
Right.
So by taking all that out and doing all the work myself, I keep my page count down. But I do lose some things. I can probably go to Barnes & Noble and order your book. And that'll do some stuff for you. You can probably get on the New York Times bestseller list. You can probably get on the USA Today bestseller list. Because you go through an actual industry, a lender. I don't.
Well, I go through a publishing company that I own, so I don't know if anybody else is going to respect it.
Yeah, but Ingram is the more well-known. Like, there's a distributor that you go through, and I don't go through a distributor. And the distributor doesn't take the cut, so I can cut my cost.
Okay.
All right. We've got another question.
Thank you.
We got one way back here?
You mentioned using social media platforms.
Yep.
And advertising.
Uh-huh.
Is there anyone in particular that you find more effective than others?
How do I say this without getting stuff thrown at me? The best thing to say is the more genuine people, the more social you are, the more successful you're going to be on social media. Certain things help. But at the end of the day, those things I'm referring to, without trying to be rude, are things that might catch initial interest. But you have to be an interesting person. So I might look at your photo because you're attractive. But I'm not going to read your post unless you're intelligent. So certain things do help, in my opinion. And it's gender neutral, by the way. I think Joshua Robertson is a great writer, a brilliant writer, and a brilliant social media guy. This is a man who just recently quit his day job, and he's doing fine, folks. I'm a big believer in C.L. Snyder. And Heidi Angel is another independent author, and her social media platform is just wicked. So those are people whom I try to emulate, but it frustrates me. I'm like, oh, you have hobbies that are interesting, and I just want to talk about writing. So that's where the balance falls into it. So you asked me to give you a few people to aim for. Is that, did I do that?
Yes, good idea. Thank you.
What do we got over here?
Could you repeat those names?
C.L. Snyder. Heidi Angel with two L's, because she's not that kind of angel. And Joshua Robertson. Those are all very, very talented. They are talented. I actually became a fan of Joshua Robertson strictly because I started seeing his social media stuff, and I fell in love with him, so I bought his book, and I thought, oh, you're actually good at writing too. Well, now I can buy all the things you write. You got me. But that's the trick. That's the magic. What else we got? How are we on time? Like, we're good, but I want to make sure I want to help you as much as I can. In the back?
We're at 36.
Oh, I got like 15 minutes. This is going to be awesome. Go ahead.
Do you do book fairs and stuff as well?
I need to be better. I need to be better at that. I see regular sales when I do regular appearances. So this year I said, these things wipe me out. I love it. I love coming here. I love doing the panels. I love talking to you all. But one, I'm not writing. I'm not social mediaing. I wouldn't do that anyway, but I'm supposed to. And then I'm up late because I'm doing work. So it's really draining. So this year my goal is 6 events. Next year my goal will be 12. And then I'll try to do 12 for a little bit. But at some point in time, look, I need to get out in flea markets. High school book fairs, things like that. I'm interested in finding them, but I'm not aware enough yet on what's available, And two, I'm worried that at some point in time I have to write. So there's always some sort of overlap. But the more I talk to people, the more I sell books. If anyone has an Amazon author page, your guys look like a heart monitor. Mine looks like the biggest, funnest slide in history. Because it's been a full 30 days since I've done an event. Now I came to AwesomeCon and it looks like Mount Everest. So when you get out and talk to people, you get to know them, and they might buy your book. That also is an indication that my social media presence is complete garbage, but I knew that. And I just have to get better there. What do we got?
We're going to get you a sandwich board that you can wear and you stand out on the corner and do that too.
Maybe a copy of my own book where I put my face in. For the record, I know that Bob looks a lot like me, but there was no intent to that. I swear to you, that is entirely coincidental. I was bald and did not own a black jacket when that cover was made. And I did not buy a black jacket and do my hair like this because of the cover. But coincidentally, that happened. What have you got?
I'm sort of wondering, sorry, I don't know how to put this. How many books did you sell when you're like, okay, I'm doing this all right? And how is your sales sort of changed over time as you published your second book? Did that improve sales of your first book? And I guess I don't have a realistic sense of how many books you someone in independent publisher could expect to sell.
Well, let me just be honest with you. I'm not quitting my day job anytime soon. Right now, this is the most expensive hobby I've ever had. There are reasons for that. Typically speaking, independent authors don't start seeing money until about 8, 9, 10 books. So my first piece of advice, don't publish your first book. Write 8 more, and then publish all of them in quick succession. So those overnight sensations, usually because they release a book every 3 or 4 months, and then before you know it, they got 10 books out, and they gained a following per book. I did it the wrong way, because dang it, I want to be published. This is my book. Do you have anything else ready? No, I'll figure that out later. I don't recommend you publish one book right away, unless this is your opus in your life stream, the memoir that will change lives. And you don't really care how it is, you just want to get your story out there, well, then put it out there. But I wouldn't recommend publishing one book and imagining that's going to be the one that lets you quit your day job. I had this fantasy where I walked into my boss and be like, it's been an honor, sir, because I do like my job. It's been an honor, sir. I'm ready to move on in life. And a little tear goes down his eyes. We're going to miss you, son. And that hasn't happened yet. You need to increase the number of your books. What I've noticed is, in my terms of sales per year and sales per month, and I don't know that I can say I have sales per week, if I'm being honest with you. But 2 years ago, I had sales per, quarter. Last year I had sales per every other month, and now I have monthly sales. The number of products I have out has helped, and the number of events I do has helped. The more work you put in and the more work you put out, the more that will work for you. Does that answer your question without making me sound too pathetic?
Yeah, actually that was great.
Okay, cool. Joshua Robinson wrote a beautiful series of books, and he's fine. He's also more intelligent and attractive than I am. So there it is. I'm way more attractive. Anyway, what do we got? I'll let you judge.
That's a bold question. You mentioned you pay for editors. Mm-hmm. Are you talking about copy editors or editors more looking at structural issues?
My editor does both, but she doesn't do both at once. That might not be the best idea, not because she can't do both, but because the reason you need editors is because you become blind. You get tunnel vision. So most people I know hire one person for content and one person for mechanics. That is the thing I would get behind if I could afford both. But I hire one person to do both, and she's done right by me so far. Is that fair? Let's keep going. Are you all ready to publish? That would be great. What do you got? Way back there? Most of my ideas are generated by ridiculous Family Guy type mental tangents I have. I watch one movie and then I go and I watch another completely different movie and I go, wouldn't it be cool if that character from that movie just showed up here? It would be way better. And then I pray I don't get sued for copyright. So that my inspiration is very spontaneous in that regard. I have another friend who all of her inspiration comes from intense research. It's as unique as the artist. Man, I keep giving you guys these metaphoric answers. Is this working for you, though?
Yeah.
Okay, what do we have? What do we have? What else we got? I have a rule. I don't care what happens, I write 1,000 words a day. Once this year, I've gone to bed before 11. It was awesome. It was hilarious. I lie down and didn't know what to do with myself. I'm like, no, I'm still thinking about writing. But I went to the bed. But the rule is, you write 1,000 words a day. You just pick it. What you gotta do is you gotta pick a number and commit to it and do that. And then it happens. It just flows. Bob took me 3 years. Hot took me a year and a half. The books I have lining up, they're way faster because my workflow's down, I have things figured out, I have editors who don't just take my book and not edit it and still charge me. That happened to me too. I'm a really oblivious, trusting child. I have more discretion than I do. So I can't give you like an exact number, but I fully anticipate on publishing 4 books next year, if not 6. Which is a huge jump when like Bob came out and then it took 2 years to get Caught out and I already had a draft done. And now I'm like, nope, I'm good. Some of those are well shorter, but some of them are full-length novels. So you will get faster as you become more proficient at the process. So right about now, I'd say a book a year isn't much to ask of myself. What else?
45.
Huh? 45. 45, so that's regrettably high, but what do you got?
So that 1,000 words, is that part of your, because you talked about character development, setting development, and all that before then you started writing plot. Is that 1,000 words included in that character development process and all that?
For me, yes. If I sit down and type, I even count my social media tweets and things like that. That's because even I have to sleep right now. I probably go to bed about 1:30 a day, and then I have to be at work at 7, or 7:30, if I'm being honest with boss, 7:30, I know, but... I have to pick a line that works for me, but I'm at my happiest when I'm drafting 1,000 words, and to be honest, when I'm drafting, it's way more than 1,000, because once the story's flowing through my fingers, that's the easy part for me. The world building and the editing is where I slow way down. They're not kicking me out yet, so I'm going to keep taking questions until someone yells at me. What do you got?
So if you're committed to like your 1,000 words a day, if you've ever had writer's block, do you have any tricks or any mental kind of steps you do to break through that to keep those 1,000 words going?
I have to confess to have never experienced the phenomenon some call writer's block. I don't want to callously state that I feel it doesn't exist. Just because I've never experienced the thing doesn't mean it doesn't exist, because marriage. That's the funny joke, that's the one that gets to laugh. Anyway, the idea is, what works for me and why I feel I've never encountered it, is I always have like the primary project. And I have experienced many times where that project's just not working. That sort of, but I have another book, I have another 2 things I'm working on. So if this book is giving me a headache, that's alright, I'll go play in the world building area. Over here for a while. So I'm still being creative, and more importantly, I'm still creating something. Now, the guys who I promised that Book 2 of Cop will be up 2019, it will, like December, but it will. But it keeps me moving creatively. What I think happens to many people is the book they want to publish, they get stuck on that, and that they let that get them stuck, period. I would find someone who's gone through that and ask them what they did for actual techniques. But I am currently under the belief that I've never experienced it, because I never let the fact that I can't keep working on this mean that I can't keep working, period. What do you got?
I've seen a few posting online where a person would self-publish a book chapter by chapter and then charge really low prices, maybe 5 or 10 cents per chapter.
I have seen people do it. I don't want to wait a week for the next episode of Doctor Who. So I don't want to wait for you to figure out. Just send me the book, dude. So it's not a thing I'm going to do, but if it works, it works. Are you guys?
Yeah.
Can you hear me back there in the door, the people with the blue shirts? Are you mad at me? Do you want me to go away? We're all having fun in here, but you may be annoyed with us by now. Are you going to let me find out for me? Okay, while you do that, I got one more question. Let's do this.
Okay, so no new questions. So what shirt we got?
That's when all of them, you talked about how the publishing companies were such a ripoff, essentially.
I wouldn't go that far. Well, that one was.
Well,
some can.
It's really important to look out for. There are a lot of people who want to take advantage of self-published authors.
Yeah, a lot of people make a lot of money off your hopes and dreams.
Exactly.
Be intelligent.
If you get solicited for something, double check
it
10 times.
You remind me.
Marketing or whatever.
Let's say your first book comes out. You're going to get a phone call from a guy with a strangely Arab accent, saying like, "Oh, we did research and we found your book and we think it'll do very well with our program and our audience, and we're going to market your book for you." And I go, "Are you going to charge me?" "Well, we're going to market your book for you." And he goes, "You are saying words that are not direct response to my question." And they don't know enough English to understand that statement, which makes me laugh more. If you are ever called by anyone not, you know, I work for Tor, I work for Del Rey, I work for this, what I tend to do now, because I don't want to be a complete jerk, is I go, "What's the name of your company?" "This is the name of my company." I write it down and I say, "I'll look into your company. If I'm interested, I'll call you back. What's your number?" 9 times out of 10, they're scams. Tom Doherty, you can call me, like, tomorrow. My phone's available. My number is on my website. You can call me. Wrap it up? All right, guys, you've been awesome. Thank you so much. I hope this has helped. If you have any more questions, quick promo, I'm on the table.
You dropped out on that.
Huh?
You turned it off.
They can hear me. I talk like a crazy person. I'm at table L04. You can come ask me more questions. I'm more than happy to that. And my books are really inexpensive because I love you. So I'll see you around. Thank you. You've been amazing. Good night.
Thank you.
Oh, and it's mlsreach.wordpress.com. I'm on Google.